of the examples, so let's do the other one. Distance formula, just to get ourselves back in the groove here. So our two points are 2, 6 and -5, 1. This notation, this is point A, this is point B. This notation always means find the distance from A to B, right? So here we go. Remember this formula, it's that big radical, right? So we're gonna subtract our x's, 2 - -5, and square that, 2 - -5. And then we're gonna subtract our y's and square that. Everybody still with me? Remember this, we talked about it on Friday? Yeah. Gotta know your distance formula. So what do we end up with here? Let's see, 2 - -5. Remember that old rule that 2 negatives make a positive, so that's gonna be 49? And 25. So I got the square root of 74. Now, remember, we have to reduce that if it reduces, right? And I don't mean type it in on your calculator. I mean reduce it, break it down. However, root 74 is 2 times 37, and 37 is prime, so we're done. That's our answer. Oh my gosh, there's one more. Try it on your own. Let's see what you come up with. Do I have a volunteer to come up on the board for us?
I will.
More than one can come up. We got lots of boards and lots of answers, so more than one can come up.
Let's get it.
If you are not at the board, you need to be doing this at your seat.
Can I erase this?
Yep. You're using your distance formula. Careful with your arithmetic. These two got the same answer, it looks like.
You gotta square it, square it, square it.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Square root.
Don't forget your square root somewhere. Here you go. All right, did all of you at your seats get root 13?
Yes.
So we're all comfortable with that. All right, next step says we're gonna find the midpoint. Okay? Now, you've done this before too. We want to find the midpoint of these two points. Now, if you get confused about this or you have forgotten how to find midpoint, I want you to remember one thing. The midpoint is the average. It's the middle point. It's the average. If you can remember midpoint is average, you're never going to miss these. Because everyone knows how to average, right? How do I find the average of two things?
Add them together and divide by 2.
That's how you find midpoint. You find the average value. So look at your x's. What's the average? Well, it would be -1 + 6 / 2, right?
Yeah.
All right, -1 + 6 is
5.
5/2. There is nothing wrong is an improper fraction. If you want to make that a decimal or a mixed number, that's up to you. But there's nothing wrong with saying 5/2. Now, let's average the y's. Average, we do exactly what Mr. Mello said. We add them up and divide by 2. So, 2 and 4 is 6, divided by 2 is, there is your midpoint. When you find midpoint, you average. You add them and divide by 2. So, what is our midpoint for these guys? Add the x's. James?
Negative 7/2 and 7/2.
Negative 7/2 and positive 7/2. That is exactly right. Add the x's, divide by 2. Add the y's, divide by 2. Again, midpoint is the average. Midpoint is the middle value, the average value. Okay? Everybody all right with that? All right, now the next problem says you got this crazy equation and we want to find the center and the radius. All right.
Radius to half.
Anybody have any idea how to do this? I don't know if you guys talked about this last year or not. Remember finding the center and the radius of a circle? All right. Well, this is a circle. Huh? Well, this is a circle. The center of the circle is at the origin, and the radius is 4. Now, if you've never done this before, you're thinking, what in the world? So let's do the next one. I think it'll be a little clearer to you. Here is the equation of a circle. The center of this circle is at 2, -3. Where did the 2 and the negative 3 come from?
The opposite
of what's in the parentheses, right? So let's back up to this one. Why was this center at 0, 0? Because there's nothing in the parentheses, right? There's no number in the parentheses. The center is the opposite of what's in the parentheses. So this was a positive 2 and a negative 3. But if you don't have any parentheses, then that means it's just 0, 0.
So there's like that AHK stuff?
Well, there's no A in there, but HK.
Yeah.
The A is with a parabola. Yeah. This is not a parabola. Okay. What's the radius? Well, now look. In this equation, there was a 16 there, and I said the radius was 4. This one has a 15, so the radius is the square root of 15. To find the radius, somebody said half, and it's not half, it's square root. It's square root. We take the square root of that number. Okay? Now, you've not done this before, so let me throw one more at you real quick. You can write this one up at the top or somewhere. What about x plus 3 squared plus y squared equals 100?
-3 0 is 30.
So where do we think the center is? Remember, it's the opposite of the parentheses, right? So we're going to have
-3.
Oh, wait, no parentheses means
zero.
So your center is at -3, 0. And the radius will be 10, the square root of that number. Okay? Everybody following along on that brand new thing? Now, if you look at the next set of problems, it says, do the opposite. So here is the center, and here is the radius. Write the equation of the circle. Okay? So you want to come up with an equation that looks like that one. Alright, so here we go. Any guesses?
X minus one squared.
X minus one squared. Everybody, whoa, slow down. Everybody with me then? It's the opposite, right? So it's going to be X minus one squared plus
X minus four squared.
Y minus four squared, right?
Equals 36.
Beautifully, beautifully done. Now we've got a center at negative 3, 2, and a radius of 10. So let's put somebody on the spot here. Alice, what do you think? Equals, yep, you were perfect, except remember that second letter is a Y. We had an X and a Y, so we have X plus 3 squared plus Y minus 2 squared equals 100. You all right? So now we're ready for the big problem. Let's look at C. C says the same thing. Write the equation of the circle. Which means this. We're going to come up with something that looks like this. But the difference is, all they told me this time was that I have a diameter. That should be a word you're familiar with. A diameter goes through the center of the circle, right? And the end points are at negative 1, 5, and 3, 7. So my job is to come up with this kind of equation. But they didn't give me the information I had before. They gave me the end points of a diameter. Okay? So, I don't want anybody shouting anything out. I want everybody in the room thinking about this for a moment. And then we'll let you shout some stuff out. In order to do this, everybody did this easily. This was not an issue. They gave me a center and a radius, right? If I know the center and the radius, I can do this. So that means somehow I got to find the center and the radius from what they gave me here. All right, let's shout out some ideas.
Distance.
What do you think?
Average distance and midpoint.
Okay, midpoint is going to be that, right? So remember, midpoint is average. So what is my average X? Add your X's and divide by 2. Your average X is 1. And your average Y is 6. So now we know our center is at 1, 6. Right? Okay. Now.
You do the same thing, the distance, just doing one of them.
Oh, now I need the distance formula, maybe from here to here?
Yeah, it doesn't really matter.
Does it matter? No. Could I do from here to here?
Yeah.
Yep, doesn't matter. Whatever you like best. That has a negative number in it, so I like positives better. So I'm going to do that one. I'm going to find the distance because that distance will be my radius, won't it? So here we go. My radius. Going to be the big square root thing again, will be 3 minus 1 squared, 7 minus 6 squared. Does that look okay to everyone? Mm-hmm. So let's see, what am I going to have? The square root of 4 plus 1, the square root of 5. So I'm going to think about now what I did before that was so easy. I had a center and I had a radius. and I could write my equation. So now I have a center, and I have a radius. I had to figure those out, but I got a center and a radius, and now I'm going to write my equation. So what's that gonna look like? Let's see. Ella, you got any ideas what that might look like? Be careful. How do I get the number that goes here? I square my radius, and if I square root 5, it's just 5. Remember, the square root gets canceled by the square, so it's just 5.
Subtracted, wasn't it 3 minus negative 1? So it wouldn't have been like 3.
Oh, wait, I'm finding the distance from here to here.
Yeah.
So it's 3 minus 1.
Oh, we're doing it from there to there.
Yeah. Because you want the radius. If you went all the way across, yeah, that's that would be the diameter.
Yeah.
Right. Anybody have a question about that? That's a big problem.
So the way you go is you go midpoint first, and then you go radius. The radius, then distance.
Then write your equation. Okay. Yeah. The radius is going to be the distance from one of your endpoints to the center. All right. Well, now it looks like we've got some absolute value to contend with. Is it?
Yeah.
Yes.
Good. So what do we know about absolute value? It's always going to end up being positive. So what we do is we think of those absolute value symbols as like parentheses, and we do what's in them first. So evaluate this. What is negative 3 plus 2?
Negative
1. So then we take the absolute value of negative 1, which is just going to be positive 1. Very, very good. Now notice, I don't take the absolute value of each piece. I figure it out first and then take the absolute value of the answer. So here we go, a little harder problem. But not if you take it a step at a time. So don't even worry about this over here. What is 4 minus 7?
Negative
3. But you're in absolute value, so it's going to be 3. Now, don't even worry about all this. Do this part right here.
4.
Negative. Q, are you okay this morning?
Good.
You seem awfully quiet and like subdued. Make sure you're taking notes now, okay? So 3 plus 1 is 4, and the absolute value of 4 is 4. And now what do I want to do with those two numbers? I want to subtract them. So the answer to the problem is
-1.
This value was 3. This value was 4. I'm subtracting 3 minus 4. Next, what's happening here?
5.
Get all that. The absolute value of 5 is 5. And the absolute value of negative 5 is
5.
And what are we doing with them? Subtracting them, so the answer is
0.
Sometimes we get a little wild and wacky, and we see two negatives and say, oh, they'll cancel each other out. No, not this time, because that one's inside an absolute value. So he's gone. He's not even really negative.
Go.
All right, one more. All right, here we go. What do you got here? Seven. What do we got here?
Negative seven, that's from the seven.
Negative seven, but absolute value is positive seven, and we are adding them, so your answer is 14. P2 done. Now, what does that mean? That means that you should have your P1 and P2 homeworks. Now, you should be able to have both of those done.
Now?
Not at this moment, but you should tonight be working on P1 and P2 homework.
Thanks, P2.
All right, here we go. Number one, P3.
Hey, folks, up.
Is negative 2 a solution of this equation? Now, there are a couple of ways that you can do this. What occurs to you, Trent? The question is negative 2 a solution of this equation? What might be one way we can handle that? How many Trents do I have in this room? I'm waiting for Trent.
Plug it in for X.
What'd you say? Did you say anything? Who are you?
Walter.
Well, you guys switch seats. Totally not fair. So you're Trent?
Yeah.
And you're Walter. Yeah. All right, you're next, Walter. Trent, what was your idea?
Plug in negative 2.
One option is just to plug in negative 2.
That would be a lot harder.
That is one option. If you want to know if you got the right answer or not, you check it. And you check it by plugging it in. Now be really careful. What's negative 2 squared?
4.
What's negative 4 times negative 2?
8.
Plus 8. Does that add up to 0 like it's supposed to?
It does.
It does. So the answer to the question is yes, negative 2 is a solution. Now, Walter, my friend, do you have another idea about how to do this problem, or are you good with that? Does that make sense to you? Huh?
I'm actually good with that.
You're good with that? And does anybody have any other ideas that you might want to come up with? Derek? Derek says, what if I solved the original equation by factoring it? That's a possibility, right? He says, in order to know if I got the right answer, I'll just work it out myself and see what I get. Well, I get x equals 6, and I get x equals negative 2.
Yep.
So the question was, is negative 2 a solution? And the answer is, yeah, I worked it out and got that answer. Now, we just did that problem twice. You only have to do it once, and you can do it whichever way is your favorite way. So what are our two ideas? Plug in the negative 2 and see if it checks out, or actually work the equation out and see if you get negative 2 as your solution. All right, number 2. Which are linear equations? Now, without me telling you anything, you want to guess which ones either are or aren't?
A is a
linear equation.
E is.
F is not linear because why?
Can anybody tell me?
It's got x squared. Alright, so A has an X to the first. You see that? E has an X to the first. F has an X to the second, so he's out.
C's not.
C is not, because to be a linear equation.
Got you.
Oh, now wait a minute. Yeah, no, it's not. Because to be a linear equation, you cannot have an X in the denominator. This is down the road a little ways, but But when you have x's in the denominator, it means your picture is going to have an asymptote in it. And we don't want asymptotes in linear equations. So no x's in the denominator. If you're going to be linear, no x's in the denominator.
So there's only two guesses.
All right, so that rules out D, right?
Yeah.
D is out.
D is not one.
What's wrong with B?
As a square root.
We don't want any x's underneath a square root. So, listen, write this down if you need to. If it's going to be linear, what can you not have? You cannot have an exponent other than one. You cannot have an x in the denominator. And you cannot have an x under a radical. So, no exponents bigger than one, or other than one. One is the only exponent you can have. No x's under a radical, no x's in the denominator. Got it? So one more time. No exponents other than one, so you can have x to the first, that's it. No x's under a radical, and no x's in the denominator.
So, if say that number B right there, or letter B, if that was like a 5 in there, would that be a line?
That would be okay.
Okay.
That would be okay. You guys have x somewhere, but yes, that would be okay. It's the x that can't be under the radical.
Yeah.
All right. Now we got a section of solving. Oh gosh, there's a lot of them.
Already
there, Mom. You already did them all because you're amazing. All right, so let's have A up here on the board. Let's have somebody come up and solve A. Now, if you are comfortable by yourself, that's great. If you'd rather bring a partner with you to help you, that's fine too.
You might partner, Dave.
So we're going to get the first three up here. And we're taping, so we got to work on this board over here. So I need the first three. Anybody who feels confident in that role?
I mean, I might as well just try that one for the fun of it.
Nobody had trouble with this one, right? We got this under control. We know we need to add 9 and then divide by 2.
Mm-hmm.
We okay with that one? This one's a little bit harder, but not too bad. We're going to add that or move the x's to the same side, move the numbers to the same side, x equals 2. This one can throw us fits because it involves fractions. In order to do the problem, no, I believe the answer is correct, but I want to show some work here. In order to solve this, you have a couple of different options. One option is what? Multiply by the reciprocal. Because if you multiply 3/2 times 2/3, don't they cancel?
Yeah.
And that's what you want. You want to have x by itself. So x equals, when we multiply fractions, we go straight across. So it's 12 over 10, which reduces to 6/5. Now, some of you, and this is the best part about math, there's lots of ways to do it. Some of you may say, I want to divide both sides by 2/3. That's okay. As long as you remember It's the same as multiplying by the reciprocal.
So why not just do the
reciprocal? You can do it however it makes sense to you to do it. Either way, your answer is going to come from multiplying 4/5 times 3/2, right? We good? Girls, everybody okay? All right, let's have new volunteers come up and try the next batch. Actually, I'm going to do number 4 because I want us to do it together. And then you guys can come up and try these other ones. Maybe some of them are hard. All right, here we go. This problem, this is number 4, or letter D. And it's going to be kind of like F and kind of like G.
Yeah, I'll do it.
4 fractions. Slay? Mr. Slay? Do you remember how to handle equations that are full of fractions like this? Well, again, there are lots of options, but the easiest way, I think, the easiest thing to do, especially for those people who are fraction phobic, is to get rid of the fractions. What is the common denominator between 3 and 4?
12.
So I am going to multiply each piece of my problem by 12. That's the common denominator. Now, why would I do that? Well, 3 goes into 12 4 times, right? So now this term doesn't have a fraction anymore. It's just 4x. What's going to happen here? 4 is going to go into the 12 3 times. And all I'm going to have left is plus 3.
Yep.
Equal to 12. Nothing cancels there, so it's just 12. And now I have a simple little equation like I had before. And my answer is 9/4. When we have equations that are full of fractions, it is oftentimes easier to just get rid of the fractions. Let's jump down to G. We'll get the other ones, don't worry. While we're talking about fractions, let's jump down there. And let's try the same trick. So let's look at our fractions. Gabby, I got a 3, a 4, and a 2. What's the common denominator for 3, 4, and 2? 12. So I'm going to do what I did before. I'm going to multiply everything by 12. Now, do you notice I'm putting that 12 in the numerator of every fraction? And I did that so that we could cancel, right? So 3 goes into 12 4 times. So what am I left with here? Be careful.
4t minus 4.
Very good. Plus. 4 goes into 12 3 times. So what am I left with here? 3t plus 15 equal to
6.
Now that is a much easier equation than we started with, isn't it? Much easier. So let's collect our terms. We have a 7t. Plus 11. We'll subtract 11 and divide. I got negative 5/7. You guys that did it already, is that what you got?
Yeah.
C. That's for letter G. How do we feel about that? Okay? All right, so we got a couple more to do. Let's have some volunteers. Let's have E and F. So E and F, new volunteers. Somebody who hasn't been up yet. Bring a friend if you don't want to fly solo.
What numbers?
E and F. The rest of you are doing them at your seats if you haven't already. You guys are friends, that's good.
Yeah.
All right, come on, I need an F volunteer. Thank you. You can bring somebody up with you if you want, or do it by yourself. Now, Hugh has the right idea. He's working it out at his seat.
What?
If you have not done these, you need to do that.
Nice job, Wilson.
I hear a lot of extraneous chatter.
Or extraneous speech.
Some of you are definitely extraneous. That's what I got, Mr. Mellow. Good job. Good job. Did you notice those of you at your seats? He brought the three over here. He times the three over here and solved the equation. And that's what I got, you guys. Awesome work. Anybody not get 11 halves for E or 7 halves for F? Comfortable with that?
Yes.
We are? All right. We're going to do a couple of practice problems because we're going to have another quizzy poo tomorrow. Yes.
Does quizzy poo only mean 3 questions?
This one's only going to have 2 questions.
Ooh.
So here we go. 2 questions tomorrow.
Oh, no.
I'm going to give you a point A and a point B. And I'm going to ask you 2 questions about this. Do you have any idea what questions I might ask you? Distance and midpoint. So the question's going to look like this. Remember, AB just means what's the distance? And then the second question will be, what's the midpoint of AB? So let's practice this together, because tomorrow you're going to have a quiz and we want to get it right. So here we go. Distance is the big radical. Subtract your x's and square them. Subtract your y's and square them. And then add those together. Is everybody comfortable with the setup? Because tomorrow you're going to do exactly the same thing. It's just going to be different numbers. All right, so here we go. 7 minus 1?
6.
Squared.
36.
10 minus negative 4? 14 squared, 196. Very good, Walter. Now, if you don't know what 14 squared is, over to the side, you're going to do 14 times 14, and you're going to figure it out. I'll try to keep the numbers smaller tomorrow. All right, now I add those up. So 196 and 36. I got 232, but check my arithmetic. Is that right? So that's the square root of 232. Now I'm going to see if it breaks down. I know it divides by 2. 116. And 116 divides by 2. And 58 divides by 2.
24. Isn't it 17?
So I got a 2, a 2, a 2, and a 29 in my breakdown. Is that what you got?
Yep.
Remember the rule? Gotta have two of them for one to break out, right?
Yeah.
So I got a pair right here, so I'll pull out 1, 2, and nothing else, so my answer is 2 square root 58.
Yeah.
Whoa, we're not done. We got the other question. We gotta find the midpoint.
Average.
Average. Average. I love it. Midpoint is average. 1 plus 7.
8.
Divided by 2.
4.
Negative 4 plus 10.
6.
Divided by 2.
3.
There's your midpoint. You should have your P1 and P2 homework done by tomorrow. I'm not collecting it, but let's get on top of it. If you have questions you need to ask me, before, you know, raise your hand and say, Miss Ford, how about this question? Can we do it? And we will. We're going to have a quiz tomorrow. Just like this one, you have to distance and midpoint. All right? And we'll get back our other quizzes. Have a good day, people.
We have flex after this.